What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who could be against us? I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things to come, nor any powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Welcome, one and all, to worship at United Church of Chapel Hill, where we join together in this affirmation that God is for us and God is with us in all times and in all circumstances. We are in the company of Christ Jesus, who delivers and who saves. When we gather for worship, we gather for this purpose, that is to grow in love of God and neighbor, and to build together a place of belonging for all God's children. All God's children have a place of belonging here. There's so much to celebrate this morning. The baptism in the Kumar family, the baseball game with the Durham Bulls. Make sure to come at 5 o'clock. You can't just show up in the first inning. You have to get there before the first pitch, 5 o'clock, and you'll get to hear the choir sing. We'd love for you to be there with us this afternoon. Don't miss everything that is written in your bulletin. I commend it to you, particularly in this time and this season, because we are doing so much to get ready for the program year in the month of August. Don't miss the announcements page. There are save the dates to remember. There are invitations to retreats and trainings and orientations. We don't want you to miss a moment of all that we are planning to do together in the year ahead. Please rise as you are able, and let us join together in the call to worship. All-seeing, all-hearing, all-knowing God, all our thoughts are open to you. Thank you for listening to our prayers and seeing us as we are. Speak to us in turn, great in your acceptance and gracious in your conviction, that with pure hearts and open hands, we may align our inner world with our outer selves. Bless us with the likeness of Christ, that we may listen as you listen, feel as you feel, speak as you speak, and love as you love. In your mercy, we are known and made new by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
morning. Today's readings tell the story of the fall of King Saul and the murder of John the Baptist. Fasten your seatbelts and put on your hard hat as we listen for what the Spirit is saying to all of us today. 1 Samuel chapter 15, selected verses. Samuel said to Saul, "I was sent by the dread God to anoint you ruler over God's people, over Israel. Now then, hearken to the call of the words of the inscrutable God. Thus says the sovereign of heaven's vanguard, I will punish Amalek for what they did to Israel, setting against them in their ascent from Egypt. Now go and smite Amalek, and put to holy destruction all that they have. Do not spare them, and put to death from woman to man, and from infant to nursing baby, and from ox to sheep, from camel to donkey." Saul seized Agag, ruler of the Amalekites, he seized him alive and put to holy destruction all the people at the edge of the sword. The word of the sovereign God to Samuel was, "I regret that I crowned Saul as ruler, for he has turned away from me, and my commands he has not instituted." Then Samuel was angry, and he cried out to the God who hears all night. And Samuel rose early in the morning to meet Saul, and it was told to Samuel, "Saul went to Carmel, where he erected a monument for himself, then turned around and passed by, going down to Gilgal." Now Samuel came to him, and Saul said to him, "Blessed are you by the Holy One of old. I have instituted the command of the Holy One of Sinai." Then Samuel said, "What is this sound of sheep in my ears, and the sound of cattle that I am hearing?" And Saul said, "They brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and the cattle to sacrifice to the Holy One your God, but the rest we have put to holy destruction." Then Samuel said to Saul, "Stop. Let me tell you what the Ancient One said to me last night." Saul replied, "Speak." Samuel said, "Though you are small in your own eyes, are you not the head of the tribes of Israel? The Holy One anointed you ruler over Israel." Saul said to Samuel, "I have sinned, for I have transgressed the utterance of the dread God and your words, because I feared the people and obeyed their voice. Now then, I pray, pardon my sin and return with me, so that I may worship the Holy One of old." From the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, verses 14 through 29. Now King Herod heard of the teaching of Jesus, for Jesus' name had become known, and some were saying, "John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and that is why his powers work through him." Yet others said, "It is Elijah," while others said, "It is a prophet like the prophets of old." But when Herod heard of it, he said, "John, whom I beheaded, has been raised." For Herod himself had sent men who seized John and bound him in prison because of Herodias, the wife of his brother Philip, for Herod had married her. For John had told Herod, "It is not right for you to have your brother's wife." Now Herodias had a grudge against him, and she wanted to kill him, but she could not. This was because Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous man and a holy man, and he protected him and listened to him, though greatly perplexed. Yet it pleased him to listen to him. Now an opportune time came on Herod's birthday when he gave a banquet for his courtiers and commanders and for the leaders of Galilee. And Herod's daughter Herodias came in and danced, pleasing Herod and his dinner guests. The king said to the girl, "Ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it to you." And he swore to her repeatedly, "Whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom." And she went out and asked her mother, "What should I ask?" She replied, "The head of John the Baptizer." Immediately she returned to the king with haste and asked, saying, "I want immediately for you to give me on a platter the head of John the Baptizer." The king was deeply sorry, yet because of his oaths and the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately, the king sent a soldier under orders to bring John's head, and he went and beheaded him in prison. And he brought his head on a platter and gave it to the girl, and the girl gave it to her mother. When John's disciples heard, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Sachin and Jacqueline, would you and your family come and join us with Sammy so that we can celebrate with you the new life that has come into the world by God's grace and has come into our community? People of God, what can we say about these waters? Come on forward and gather around this font of living water. This is the water that God has sent to nourish all of creation. This is the water that Moses and the Hebrew people have passed through to find new life in the promised land. This is the water into which Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River. This is the water of that well that a woman came and met Jesus beside. And Jesus said to her, "Whoever touches this water has everlasting life." So this is water that washes and cleanses. It's water that gives life and nourishes. It's water that delivers. It's water that welcomes all of us into the family of God's goodness and grace. And today we share that water with Sammy and with your family. Jacqueline, can you tell us who is all gathered around here?
Yeah, I'm Jacqueline. This is my husband, Sachin.
Jacqueline and Sachin.
I got Sammy.
And Sammy.
This is her godfather, John, my brother. And our godmother, Aliza, my sister-in-law.
Godparents, John and Aliza, welcome.
And their children, Addie, Josie, and Noel.
Addie, Josie, and Noel, we're so glad to have you here, too. Joe.
Aunt Beth and Uncle Fred.
Welcome. Is there anybody who couldn't be here today?
Yes, she has another godmother, Kira, and godfather Ritesh.
Kira and Ritesh, also godparents, couldn't be here today, but we are bound together with them by the power of the Holy Spirit, and they are present here also as we welcome Sammy into the family of God. There's a liturgy in your bulletin. We are gathered to present Samaya Anna Marie Kumar to the church and to dedicate this child to God. What can we affirm about this child? they were bringing children to Jesus that Jesus might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. But when Jesus saw it, Jesus was indignant and said to them, the sacrament of baptism is an outward and visible sign of the grace of God. Baptism with water and the Holy Spirit is the mark of our acceptance into the care of Christ's church, the sign and seal of our participation in God's forgiveness, and the beginning of our growth into the full Christian faith and discipleship. We have some questions for you as parents and as godparents and as grandparents and members of Sammy's family. All of us in this community are part of Sammy's life of faith and her spiritual journey. So all of us participate in making these covenant promises. Jacqueline Sachin, do you desire to have your child baptized into the faith and family of Jesus Christ?
Yeah.
Will you encourage Sammy to renounce the powers of evil and to receive the freedom of new life in Christ?
Will
you teach Sammy that she may be led to profess the love of Christ through her words and her actions? Do you promise, by the grace of God, to be Christ's disciples, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and word of Jesus Christ as best you are able? Do you promise, according to the grace given to you, to grow with Sammy in the Christian faith, to help her to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ by celebrating Christ's presence, by furthering Christ's mission in all the world, and by offering the nurture of the Christian church so that she may affirm her baptism? One of the traditions of our congregation is to make a testimony every time we mark the grace of God and God's presence in someone's life. And so one day, when Sammy is older, she will participate in the tradition of confirmation, by which we give testimony to how God's love has moved in our lives. This year, our confirmation class has written this statement of faith. So as Sammy will one day participate in writing such a statement of faith, we remember the testimony of our church community today. Let's all join together in the statement of faith. We believe that God is good, a higher power that guides us, a manifestation of hope in which we can believe, a leap of faith, and a loving entity that helps people feel safe and secure. We believe that Jesus was a healer, activist, and prophet who spread God's word and teaches us how to love our neighbor. We believe he was a human who challenged orthodoxy and is still with us today. We believe the Holy Spirit is present and unique to every soul it resides in, the essence of Christianity, a moral compass, and what connects us to God, inspiring, motivating, and moving us when we pray. We believe the church is more than a place. It is the people, a common body of Christianity, a sanctuary, a safe place to process beliefs and questions, and a place of belonging with a strong connection to God. Sammy, would you come and visit with me for just a moment? Do you mind?
It's okay.
No? No? It's okay.
I'm here.
It's okay.
I'm here.
We're going to stay right here. It's okay. It's okay. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we give you thanks and praise for Sammy's life, for her family, for everyone who loves her and will walk with her. And we pray, loving God, that as she receives the gift of your life in baptism, that she may always remember that she has a place to belong here and a place in your everlasting and loving heart. It's all right, Sammy. It's all right. It's all right. Can you remind me Sammy's full name?
Samaya Anna Marie Kumar.
Samaya Anna Marie Kumar, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, one God and Mother of us all. May God's grace always keep you and walk with you and go with you all your days long. Let's take a walk around the sanctuary and introduce Sammy to her church family. We'll stay here for just one more second. Maybe there are other children here who would like to come down and say hello to Sammy. Anitra, would that be okay? Yeah? So all the children of the church come and join with us, and Sammy has decided she's pretty comfortable in the spotlight down here. Yeah. Come on down and say hello to our new friend. Come on down. Hey, y'all can join us too if you'd like. The adults, you can go back to your seats if you would feel more comfortable there. Others can join us here and sit here on the chancel steps. Yeah.
Buddy?
Yeah, we want to introduce everybody to Sammy. You have a place in Sammy's life here. I have a couple questions for you. Eli, Justin, are you all willing to walk with Sammy in her faith journey? Yeah? Will you welcome her into Sunday school? Will you help her out if she needs anything? Of course you will. Of course we will. Of course we will. Sachin, Jacqueline, we want you to know that we are so grateful to have you part of our community, and we will do anything we can to support you and to walk with Sammy as she grows in her life of faith. And I hope that this community of children can be a wonderful group of neighbors and friends to Sammy as she grows older. Okay, you can go back to your seat.
Okay, thanks,
if you need a towel, here's a towel.
Sammy, you're welcome to join us for the children's moment if you want. Being the youngest among us, yeah. Yeah, just stay right here if you want. Let me grab my Legos from Miss Barb and maybe this. Thank you. Perfect timing. Welcome, friends. Welcome. Claire, you can sit. You want to sit with me? Want to sit between me and Pastor Cameron? Would that make you feel safe? Right here? Perfect. So happy to see you. What a beautiful morning. I'm wondering how many of you can't stop smiling. Yes? What a beautiful moment to welcome a child into our congregation, to witness a beautiful baptism, and to see her so happy. Yes? And full of light and joy. Yes? Did you see what just happened? She just yawned. How many of you also yawn when you see someone yawn? Yes. Did you know that expressions are contagious? They are. So when we see someone yawn, sometimes it makes our bodies remember that we're tired and we yawn. Or when we see. Yes, I feel that, Sammy. I do. Eli was feeling a little tired on the way in, and I was feeling that too. And as we turn toward Compassion Camp this week, that is the beginning of compassion, is when you are able to see the people in front of you and when you are able to feel what they're expressing and express it yourself, you start to begin to feel empathy. And only when you have empathy can you start to have compassion for those around you. How many of you know what this is? Eli is helping me. What is this, Eli? What are these? Legos. Justin, do you love Legos too? Jack, do you love Legos too? I wonder if you have ever stepped on one of these. Parents, yes. Grandparents, people who love children, grown-ups, yes. So if I were to step on one of these Legos, will you hold that for me, Justin? Would you also have to step on one to know that that hurt my foot? No. You would have a shared experience, and you would know that if Miss Anitra stepped on this Lego and I said, ouch, that you could feel that too, right, Justin? And what might you say, Justin, if I said, ouch, what might you say to me? I'm sorry that happened, Miss Anitra. I see that that hurt, right? You didn't have to be hurt to understand that I was hurting, right? And that's why seeing other faces and being present with people is so important. And that, my friends, is what we are going to do in Compassion Camp this week. So I don't want to put Pastor Cameron on the spot, but would you say a prayer for us to bless us as we begin Compassion Camp? And
absolutely.
And then afterward, we will sing our song, and you're welcome to go to the nursery with me, or you're welcome to stay here with your grown-ups.
Compassion Camp is our vacation Bible school that will take place this week, and so our worship today really kicks off Compassion Camp, and we will say a prayer to bless everyone who is joining in Compassion Camp this week. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we give you thanks for these children and for these families, and we pray that they would experience a week of joy and community, of love, and grow in empathy and compassion, that we may share the love that you have given us with our neighbors selflessly and generously, and that we may make each other smile for the happiness that we have. And the compassion that we enjoy first comes from the generosity of your love. Through Christ we pray. Amen. If you're in Compassion Camp this week, I hope you have a wonderful time, and I'll see you there. I'll see you there tomorrow.
Thank you.
Let us pray together. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O God. You are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Jackson's people have a name for this game. They call it Dutch Bingo. And like all games in Jackson's family, the rules are strictly enforced. Rule number one, only certain people can play. Rule number two, if you are one of those people, you get to play whenever you want, in the presence of other people who can't play. And rule number three, the people who can't play don't complain. They smile and wait patiently for the game to be over, no matter how long it takes. Well, we all know this game, and I'm sure we've all played it before, even if we aren't Dutch. It's the who do I know that you also know game. For people in the little Dutch colonies of northwest Iowa, or perhaps of west central Michigan, everybody is related to everybody. If you just play Dutch Bingo long enough to identify your shared connections. But you know as well as I do, it's not just those little immigrant communities from the Netherlands. You can play the game if you're a Lutheran from Lake Wobegon or a Baptist from Dallas. Have you ever met an Episcopalian from Virginia? They are absolutely the worst. As for myself, it takes a great measure of self-restraint to keep from playing this game anytime I meet somebody who has the slightest connection to the college that I went to. Whenever I'm introduced to somebody who went to Davidson College, in the company of other people who don't share our same experience of that small school, I have to remind myself that everybody else here doesn't give two licks who we know in common. It's rude to carry on a private conversation in public. Maybe for you, it's a school or a camp you attended or another place you love to go where the culture was thick and all the people were intimately known. You can play the game with reference to any community where you belonged or any extended family that knew you by name. And the game is always played with the heart swell of recognition. Somehow, we belong to each other. Your tribe is my tribe. It's the power of instant kinship that makes the game so irresistible to the insiders. And yes, so unbearable to the outsiders. Of course, there are all sorts of advantages to kinship connections. I'm sure we can all think of occasions when the grace of recognition and the trust of belonging led us to some mutual benefit. Blessed be the tie that binds. But of course, we've all seen it the other way too. In politics, the excesses are known as nepotism. In business and law, we use the language of conflicted interests. In our own communities, we've learned to develop tests for equity and inclusion because our well-worn habits of working with those who are known and trusted inevitably create barriers to difference and diversity. The ties that bind, sometimes, bind our neighbors out. The familiarity of kinship so beclouds the judgment of Saul that the prophet Samuel accuses the king of a grave sin. The war narrative in the text that was read this morning draws in stark relief the battle lines and the uniforms. In war, if anywhere, we should be able to tell who belongs to who and where one's loyalties lie. But as Israel approaches the army of Amalek, they encounter a clan known as the Kenites, who have not yet chosen sides. Now, the Kenites don't wish for a conflict with Israel's army, but they have no other reason to turn on the Amalekites. As Finland is to Russia and NATO, the Kenites are pressed to choose sides in a conflict that now engulfs them. And against the advice of the prophet Samuel, King Saul accepts their plea and lets them go. At first glance, it seems like an act of mercy. But it turns out that the Kenites had family connections to the Israelites. Family connections going way back to Moses, whose father-in-law belonged to this tribe. Would Saul have been so gracious to others, unable to drop the name of the great Hebrew deliverer? Who knows? Saul's favor to the Kenites is part of a long tradition of kindness shown on the basis of kinship. And the lexical association of kindness and kinship partly illustrates how we give favor to those having any basis of relationship to us. Kindness means literally to treat others as if they are our own. It's easy enough to perceive the seductive dangers of kinship. We flatter ourselves by giving affection to those who are like us. Kindness toward others who are of our own kind is a form of self-love. And we can spot the sin in others much more easily than we can spot it in ourselves, don't you think? But too much love for our own kind is such a common disorder in our relationships. It's how we find ourselves in neighborhoods and churches full of people who look and think and act and believe so much like ourselves. It's how we come to love the sound of our own voices on social media. It's how we come to like everyone who has ideas that are very much like our own. It's how we find ourselves with so few cross-ideological friendships, and how we are sometimes surprised to notice in ourselves such hostility to those who differ from how we think or believe. We have too much love for our own kind. Twisted are the ties that bind. But the remarkable grace of the gospel is that God's love for us is love for those of such a different kind. Jesus is God's body taking on a different form so that our humanity may be made of one kind with God's divinity. God's love extends to all things that are different and enfolds all forms that are unalike. The divine love creates kinship across the boundaries of tribe and race and family. It is love that transgresses all of the borderlines that we have established. To imitate this kind of selfless love for all kinds is what makes the message of Jesus so radical and so challenging. Paul's summation of the gospel is unintelligible to communities that have grown accustomed to the distinctions between themselves. There is no longer Jew or Greek, Paul says. There is no longer male or female, slave or free. All are one in Christ Jesus. To show love without regard to one's own kind is the preposterous vocation of being Christian. It is a form of grace that we all fall short of achieving, and still it is a form of grace that we all receive in the love of God. Baptism is the symbol of the kindredness of everyone. Water that blesses the humanity of all creation cannot be taken to make distinctions from the unity of Christ's body. This is water that welcomes everyone into the family of God. To Samaya, we say, as to everyone here, you are made in God's own image. So it doesn't matter who you know. It doesn't matter who you don't know. It makes no difference whether you're well connected or completely left out of the game. You are already known by name in the body of Christ. You are of one kind with Jesus Christ. So, the kindness of God's grace extends to you. Amen.
Be seated. The blessings of God extend to all of creation, and all of us are included in the kinship of God's family. And so it is with open hearts and generous hands that we reach out to one another and extend the kindness of God's love with our neighbors.
we turn our hearts and our minds in prayer to the living God. Let us pray. God, who sustains us, who is with us in our coming and our going, in our living and our dying, in our leisure and our striving, in our loneliness, and in the relationships that sustain and nurture us, we give you thanks and praise for your accompaniment. Thank you for sustaining, thank you for your sustaining and abiding love. Teach us to accept your love for us. Teach us to accept your love for our neighbors. Teach us to accept your love for strangers. And teach us how to live in the midst of all of that love. Teach us how to love even as we heal. We pray for protection. God, protect us from the trauma of living amongst those who do not love us. And protect us, God, from engaging in those things that bring trauma to others. Protect us from lies about our value, so that we may be sustained by your grace. We pray, God, for that you would sustain those among us who need a little extra care this week. We pray, God, prayers for the healthy delivery of a new baby daughter to Melissa and Jack. God, by your grace, hear our prayer. We pray healing prayers for Linda Sellers, who has COVID. God, by your grace, hear our prayer. For Daniel Rosamond, father of Matt Rosamond, who was called to the Eternal Church this week, who died this week. God, by your grace, hear our prayers. We pray for those struggling with workplace issues, with the pain of working and maneuvering in places that are not healthy. God, by your grace, hear our prayer. We celebrate this week. We celebrate and welcome Jenny Schultz Thomas and kids, her kids and their family. God, by your grace, hear our prayers. We pray prayers of comfort for Louise Bush, whose sister, Kitty, died this week. God, by your grace, hear our prayers. And we celebrate with Kathy and Michael Paws, who celebrated their wedding anniversary this month. God, by your grace, hear our prayers. God, we pray for those on our prayer list. We pray that you would be with them this week and that you would hold them in our hearts and our minds as we go about our weeks. We pray for Faye and for her daughter Brittany, for Nancy and Ross, for their daughter Jenny. We pray for Matt as he grieves his father's death and for Karen, who is recovering from surgery. We pray for Portia, a friend of Lori, and for Sharon and Jenny. We pray for Amy's mother, Mary Lou. We pray for Liz, for Carmen and her family, for Phronsie, and for Rachel. God, by your grace, hear our prayer. God, as we live into our baptisms, as we live into our commitments as a people who follow the risen Lord, show us our next steps. Make our paths plain. Teach us, God, how to be bearers of your love and your light in this world. Lift us from the waters. Lift us dripping with grace and hope. Lift us from our graves, no longer bound by those things that tether us to our brokenness. Redeem us, God. Redeem us and change us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We turn now to the celebration of the Lord's table. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Family of God, we gather at this table, remembering the deep and abiding love of the one who sustains us. As we gather at this table, we remember together. We remember that on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and breaking it, Jesus said, "This is my body broken for you. Whenever you eat this bread, remember me." And likewise, Jesus took the wine, the cup, and pouring it, Jesus said, "This is my blood poured out for you. Whenever you drink this cup, remember me." And so we gather at this table remembering the bread of heaven and the cup of grace, and remembering that they are for us. This is an open table. This is the Lord's table. And so we believe that it is an open table, and all who wish are welcome. Come, enjoy the feast.
Thank you.
now this prayer of thanksgiving. Join with me now in this prayer of thanksgiving. We give thanks, gracious God, that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You are invited to rise in body or in spirit as we sing together hymn number 306, The Church of Christ.
Beloved people of God, go forth into the world in peace with faith in God's power for life, hope for the coming reign of God, and love for all whose lives touch yours. And may the blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, go with you, abide in you, and shine through you.